Millions of Christians all over the world today are gathering for Easter Sunday celebration. And I want to talk to you today around the topic of Easter, kind of in a backdoor fashion. But the topic today is the topic changed. And I want to invite you, if you have your Bibles, to turn to 1 Corinthians chapter 15. This is kind of the premier passage as far as the resurrection is concerned in the Scripture. 1 Corinthians chapter 15. I'm not the smartest guy in the world, and I know that. And there's a lot of things in this world that I look at and I just don't get. I don't understand. In fact, I was having a conversation with my 16-year-old son about this. I think it was just last week or the week before. And I can't remember exactly what we saw. I think it was a skyscraper. And he said something like, "Man, it's amazing that something that big and that tall can remain standing." And I said, "I know, it's stories and stories tall." And I said, "I don't understand structural engineering, right? But for some reason, that thing can stand up and withstand storms and not topple over. It's amazing." And then I said, "And cruise ships, I don't understand how cruise ships can carry thousands of people and weigh tons and tons of weight and yet float in the ocean to go out into the Gulf and be stranded." And I said, "And I don't understand airplanes. I mean, how can an airplane weighing tons carry 300 people 30,000 feet in the air and sustain itself up in the air? I just don't get it. I don't understand aerodynamics enough to understand it, but it happens. It's there, right? It exists." And that's really kind of the thing that I want to talk to you about today. We may not understand the way things operate. We may not understand how they occur, but we understand the effect of them. We witness the fact almost after the fact. We understand them by their result, by their consequence, by their effect. And in my feeble mind, in trying to understand these things, I look at the resurrection and I go, wow. It's hard for me to wrap my brain around the resurrection and completely understand it. By faith, I trust it. By faith, I believe in it. And by faith, I understand that it occurred. But for me today, and this is what I want to share with you, for me today, what I understand more than anything else about the resurrection is its impact, is its effect, is its consequence, is its result. Because I have been changed by the power of the resurrection. And that's not a testimony about how great my cares is, believe me. It's about the grace of God. Many, if not most of you, have been changed by the power of the resurrection, God's power at work in your life. And it's resulted in some things for you. Now, we're going to look at a passage of Scripture today where we're going to see this theme of change in the life of the Apostle Paul. There's probably no greater example than the Apostle Paul of the power of the resurrection at work in the life of an individual, seen from its impact, seen from its result, seen from its effect. There are many, many reasons to believe in the resurrection, many of them. The resurrection has evidence in the fact that it was predicted through prophecies in the Bible. The resurrection is evidenced by the fact that Jesus' own testimony, his claim of being God, and then his claim to rise from the dead is reasons to believe in the resurrection. The empty tomb, his appearances to people after the resurrection, all those are reasons to believe. But there's another reason. That's what I want to talk to you about today. And that reason is life change. The resurrection has resulted in the life change of millions of people throughout the centuries who have placed their trust in Christ, in what he did as Savior. So let's look at the Apostle Paul, because he was one of those people. In 1 Corinthians chapter 15, beginning in verse 3, Paul is describing the resurrection, and he's doing so by way of introduction. Look at what he says. "For what I received, I passed on to you as of first importance." Now he's about to outline what are the most important facts of Christianity. And these facts sometimes get lost, okay? But Paul's saying these are the things that are most important, that Christ died for our sins according to the Scripture, that He was buried, that He was raised on the third day according to the Scriptures. Now that is the essence of the gospel, those three things, that Christ died, that He was buried, that He was raised again. That is the essential message of the gospel, of Christianity. And those three things, when someone places their trust in Christ, they come to not only acknowledge these things, but to trust and believe in these things, that Jesus died for our sins, that He was buried, and that He was resurrected. And look what else he says in verse 5. And that He appeared to Cephas, that's the Apostle Peter, and then to the 12. After that, He appeared to more than 500 of the brothers and sisters at the same time. You understand, the resurrection of Christ was not some private, tucked away ceremony. It was a very public thing. And it's rooted in history as a very public event. Roman soldiers witnessed it. An unbelieving world witnessed it. Doubting disciples witnessed it. And here Paul is saying that Christ appeared for many days to many people, and in fact, to 500 people at one time. A very public event. He says, most of whom are still living. In fact, he's saying this. If you don't believe what I'm saying, go and ask Joe down the street. He was there. He saw it. Most of whom are still living, though some have fallen asleep. Though some have died is the point. Then, Paul says, he appeared to James, then to all the apostles, and then last of all, he appeared to me also as to one abnormally born. Now, that's an interesting phrase, abnormally born. Really what he's saying is as to one who was born late. So with our firstborn, he was 2 weeks late, and it was a little abnormal to wait and wait. And that's the apostle. He was late getting to the party. He was the last one to whom Christ appeared. So he was born, but he was abnormally born, not as the others were born, in the first eyewitnesses of Christ, but that Christ appeared to him lastly of all. And then in verse 9, here's really where the message begins. He says, "For I am the least of the apostles, and do not even deserve to be called an apostle." Why? Because I persecuted the church of God. Now, many of you know the story of the Apostle Paul, that he was once named Saul. And he was a Pharisee. He was a Jewish leader. And he was a Jewish leader of prominence. He was well-educated. He had power. He had wealth. And he, as a Jewish leader, persecuted the first century church. The Bible describes how Saul would drag Christians off in chains and throw them in prison, even witnessing and standing, approving of the martyrdom, the execution of the Apostle Stephen when they stoned him. Paul was there at the stoning of the Apostle Stephen. He gave approval of it. He gave consent to it. And Paul is humbled. He's saying, "I don't even deserve to be called an apostle, because I persecuted the church." Here was a man who is now a Christian who once aimed to destroy Christianity. He was changed. We'll come back to that in just a second. He says in verse 10, "But by the grace of God, I am what I am, and His grace to me was not without effect." Paul said that the resurrection that I just described, me becoming one born into Christ, I am now an apostle, and God's grace to me was evident. It's evident in the fact that I am today what I am because of that grace and because of the resurrection. And he says this, that grace, that power of the resurrection was not without effect. I love the way that he says that, because he says it in the double negative. It was not without effect. Another translation says, it did not prove vain. In other words, he's saying it did have an effect. It did prove itself in my life. The evidence was there because of the result and the consequences that it had in my life. So, what does this phrase, the effect of God's grace, mean? What does it mean in verse 10? Well, let me share with you. The first thing is kind of implied, and you have to understand this. The first thing that Paul is describing here is that there's a difference between mental agreement with a fact and belief in it, in actual belief in it, in trusting belief in it. And this difference is crucial. It's the difference between knowledge about something and trust in something. And as far as Christianity is concerned, it's the difference between religion, which seeks to earn its way into God's favor, and relationship, which seeks to accept what God has done for us. You see, religion is spelled D-O. Relationship with Christ is spelled D-O-N-E. It was done for us because we couldn't do it ourselves. And so the difference between merely mentally ascending to something and acknowledging something, having knowledge about something, is completely different than placing our trust in it. And it's the difference between having a hypocritical kind of faith where pretense is important, the way that we look on the outside is important, people looking at us and believing certain things about us is really, really important. That's pretense. That's hypocrisy. That's about knowledge. And instead, authentic faith. Authentic faith. Where our faith is expressed from the inner of our being outwardly. Let me give you an example of this. This water that I have up here on the stand. Do you believe it exists? I hope you do. Yes, it exists, right? I believe it exists. In fact, I not only believe it exists, I believe it will quench my thirst. That's how much I believe in it. But there's another level to belief. You see, so far, that's just knowledge. That's an exchange of my mind. I believe it exists. I believe it will quench my thirst. But what must I do to prove that it will do what it claims to do? I must pick it up and I must drink it. That's the difference between knowing something and experiencing something. And this is what I want to say to you today. And when Paul is describing the effect of the grace of God in his life, he's not describing a commitment to a new way of living, a commitment to a religion, just to do religion better. He's not talking about a resolution. He's not talking about committing himself in devotion to a moral code, to a way of living. That's not what he's describing. He's talking about the grace of God that has come into his life and been experienced in his being that has transformed his very, very self. And that's a huge, huge difference that you've got to understand. Easter is not about knowing something. There are many people who believe that Jesus exists. They may even believe that he is the Savior. They may even believe that he could save them and forgive them. But what they've never done is translated that belief into trust and acted upon that belief in such a way that they've actually experienced Christ in their life. And that's what Paul is describing as the effects. Secondly, this is what he's saying. Secondly, he's saying that trusting belief in Christ and his resurrection leads to a transformed life. You see, authentic faith in Christ, not playing church, authentic faith in Christ leads to something. It is not without effect, he says. It leads to a transformed life. It results in transformation because that belief in what he did through the resurrection accompanies the belief that we understand who Jesus was, who he claimed to be, and we understand what he did for us. And it's an amazing, amazing truth that transforms us. And it transformed the Apostle Paul. And here's the third thing that's true about the effect of God's grace. This effect, this result, provides evidence. Again, all kinds of reasons to believe in the resurrection. Prophecies, Jesus' claim, the empty tomb, his appearances. But the changed life, the effect of God's grace provides evidence of the supernatural power of his resurrection. And some of you can identify with the Apostle Paul because Christ has changed you. And it's not been about finding religion. It's not been about church attendance. It's been about an exchange where you have given your life in order to gain Christ's. That's what happened with the Apostle Paul, and he talks about it all over the New Testament. In fact, look in 1 Timothy chapter 1. He says this, I thank Christ Jesus our Lord, who has given me strength that he considered me trustworthy, appointing me to his service. Even though I was once a blasphemer and a persecutor and a violent man, I was shown mercy because I acted in ignorance and unbelief. Look at this. The grace of our Lord was poured out on me abundantly, along with the faith and love that are in Christ Jesus. Here is a trustworthy saying that deserves full acceptance. Paul is saying this, if you don't get anything else, if there was ever a truth that was a truth, if there ever was a reality that was a fact, Paul is saying, here it is, that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, of whom I am the worst. And folks, people can argue about the facts of the resurrection all they want with you, about that the disciples were just hallucinating, that Jesus didn't really die. You can argue all that you want, but you cannot argue with a changed life. And the Apostle Paul was changed. In Philippians chapter 3, again, verse 7, he says, but whatever was to my profit, in that context, he's talking about the things that he had before Christ. As I mentioned, he was popular, he was wealthy, he had prestige, he had power, he had prominence. He was well-educated. Paul probably had the equivalent of 2 or 3 PhDs. He could speak 5 languages. He was not a have-not kind of guy. He says, but whatever was to my profit, whatever I had, look at what he says, I now consider loss for the sake of Christ. What is more, I consider everything a loss compared to the surpassing greatness of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord, for whose sake I have lost all things. I consider them rubbish, that I may gain Christ and be found in him, not having a righteousness of my own. He's not talking about religion. Not having a religion that comes from the law, but that which is through faith in Christ. The righteousness that comes from God and is by faith. And then he says this in verse 10, I just want to know Christ and the power of his resurrection, and the fellowship of sharing with him in his sufferings. Boy, was he changed. Paul was changed. He was changed in 3 ways. His past was forgiven. All those things that made him guilty before God, he was cleansed of. He was forgiven. All the guilt, all the judgment, all the wrongdoing, all the persecution, God showed mercy to him. His past was forgiven. His present was empowered. Paul now experienced a strength, a supernatural strength, a power in the present tense. He got up every morning. He was not alone. He had someone there with him to empower him through the power of the Holy Spirit, to give him the strength to live each and every day. His present tense was empowered. And then finally, his future was redirected. See, God brought this sweeping change in his life, and it absolutely redirected the purpose and plans of his life. He now had a different future. He now had a new way of living. He now had a different final destination. He was changed. And there stands no greater example of life change than this man who once persecuted the church, who now became the greatest apostle of the church. He once aimed to destroy. In fact, that's what J. Oswald Sanders says. Look at the quote. He says this, it was a method worthy of God. In other words, only God could do this. Only God could be this creative. Only God could come up with this kind of plan. It was a manner, method worthy of God to select the most aggressive and influential enemy of the church and its bitterest persecutor, and to transform him into the greatest apostle, the profoundest theologian, the most persuasive apologist, and the most tireless missionary of the church that he once aimed to destroy. Only God could do that. There's the proof of the resurrection, folks. There was a power that existed that Paul acclimated, that Paul accessed, that Paul accepted, that was beyond his strength to change his own life. How do you account for that kind of life change? The resurrection. That's how. It was true of the Apostle Paul. For those of us who have put our faith in Christ, it's true for you and me. And that's what we celebrate on this Easter Sunday. That outside of our own strength, outside of our own resources, that there was a power. And that power was Christ risen from the grave. And that power, that same power that rose Christ from the grave, lives within us. That same power that conquered death. Death died that day. That power lives in here. And there's nothing like that truth. That's the effect of God's grace. So here's what Easter means. Three things real quickly as we close. Easter means this. It means the power of God is the power to change the very structure of who I am. Not patch me up. Not prop me up. Not give me a new resolution, a recommitment. It's not that. It's a transformation of my very nature. My identity has changed. I'm not the same person I was. That's what Paul says in verse 10. By the grace of God, I am what I am. And then he says in 2 Corinthians 5:17, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old has passed away. And thank God for that truth. Secondly, the power of God is the power to help me become someone I never dreamed possible. Can you imagine the Apostle Paul thinking about his life? Maybe toward the end of his life, thinking, how in the world did I end up where I am? I was a Jew. I was a Pharisee. I was a religious leader. And here I am now dying for the cause of Christ. Oh, but the grace of God. He said in verse 10, and his grace to me was not without effect. It had an effect. And some of you today, you go, man, I'm not the same person I was. I'm not the person that I need to be, but thank God I'm not the same person I was. That God has changed me, that God is changing me. Now, most of you know my story. I didn't grow up in a Christian home. I never attended church. Church and stuff about Christ was as removed from me as anything else. The only thing I knew about it was what I saw on TV, and that kind of scared me, to be honest. And someone shared with me at the age of 17 the love of God and that Jesus died for my sin. And I accepted Christ as my Savior. But for someone to have said to me before Christ, guess what, Mike, one day you're going to be standing up on Sunday morning teaching the Bible to people, I would have laughed at them. I might have slapped them. That was the furthest thing that I could have ever imagined me doing with my life. It was so foreign to me. And when I think about it, I just laugh about it because it was just so, so different. But I'm so glad that God knew what I didn't know. And I'm so glad that he had a plan and purpose for me. Beyond my reasoning, beyond my strength, beyond my logic. That's the power of the resurrection. Some of you have experienced the same thing. You go, I'm not the same person I was 10 years ago, 15 years ago, last year. Because of the power of the resurrection. And then third, the power of God is the power to transform me from this life into the next. You see, the change that begins here on this earth does not end here on this earth. It takes us into eternity. And for those of us who have been changed by Christ, the truth is that when you die, heaven is your home. And that same power of the resurrection that raised Jesus from the grave will raise you from the grave one day. And you will be transformed in likeness into eternity. Death now is a transition. And you will be changed ultimately and fully. One day, there in heaven. And Paul talks about it in 1 Corinthians 15. Let's look at it real quick. Down in verse 42, he's talking about the resurrection. He says, so it will be with the resurrection of the dead. He says, the body that is sown perishable, it is raised imperishable. The body that is sown in dishonor, it is raised in glory. It is sown in weakness, it is raised in power. It is sown a natural body, it is raised a spiritual body. We will have different bodies at that point. And then down in verse 53, he says, "For the perishable must clothe itself with the imperishable, and the mortal with immortality. When the perishable has been clothed with the imperishable and the mortal with immortality, then the saying that is written will come true." This is a prophecy from the Old Testament book of Hosea. "Then this saying will come through," he says. "Death has been swallowed up in victory." And then Paul mocks death. "Where, O death, is your victory? Where, O grave, is your sting?" Death occurs to all of us, but for those of us who are in Christ, it has no sting. It has no lasting effect. It was conquered. The resurrection of Christ, the physical, bodily resurrection of Jesus. So we have been changed, we are being changed, and guess what? We will be changed on that beautiful, beautiful day. I'm so glad that the grace of God was poured out abundantly upon me, that I knelt beside my bed at the age of 17 and I cried out to God for the very first time. I prayed my first prayer and I said, "God, forgive me. God, come into my life. I accept Christ as my Savior." And I cried myself to sleep that night. But I woke up the next morning changed. I had been forgiven. I had a new present tense in my life. And I had a new future. And I'm so happy for that day. And it still exists today. I get giddy around this time of year. Many of you do too. Some outside the church go, "Why do those Christians get all fired up about Easter?" This is why. We've been changed by it. And it's not a result of our goodness. Lord knows we've got so many imperfections and failures and weaknesses and sins. It's because of the grace of God that was ours in Christ Jesus. And it has a lasting effect. Paul says it best, it was not without effect. Since that day, yeah, I have a hard time understanding Christians who say, I'm lonely. And I understand what they're talking about from the standpoint of human relationships. But I've never been lonely since that day. I've never been alone. If I'm in my car by myself, if I'm on a plane, if I'm in the mountains, in the woods, there has been a presence of God with me. I've never, ever not felt that presence. Where once there was a fear of death, and this is just me, but I don't fear dying. I really don't. Now, I don't have a death wish. I'm not looking for it. But when it happens, it's all the better. The same is true for many of you. And this Easter Sunday, we rise up and we say, there's a lot of reasons to believe that Jesus rose from the dead. He said he would. The empty tomb, he appeared, the prophecies, all those reasons. But the one reason that I have today in my life that proves and gives evidence to his resurrection is that he is alive, because he is alive in me. And that is the best news in the world. I've been changed. I'm going to ask the worship team to come up now. They're going to do a song for us as we close the service today that talks about this change. And I want you to listen to the words of this song, and I want you to identify. It's kind of the story of someone, in fact. It's a story of someone who'd been changed. And I want you to listen to it. And on this Easter Sunday, I want you to reflect back. Some of you, many, many years. Some of you recently, reflect back upon the goodness and grace of God in your life as he's changed you.
I came up out of the water, raised my hand up to the Father, gave it all to Him that day, felt new and kissed my face, walked away, with eyes wide open, finally see where I was going. It didn't matter where I've been, I'm not the same man I was then.
Changed. Let's stand for closing prayer. Father, we praise you. Words cannot express what we feel in our hearts for the grace and the mercy, the love that is ours through your Son, Christ Jesus, who was buried in defeat but raised in victory. And the power of God that raised him from the dead is the power that lives in us. Thank you, God. Some of us, Father, it's been a few years since we've remembered. I pray that you would renew in our hearts the full awareness, the gift of your Son, today that we'd be touched, that we would remember the good that you brought into our lives because we were changed. Others, it's more recent. Father, for others, they're still seeking. We pray for them. We pray that we'd be a church that helps others experience the grace and mercy and life change that we've been so blessed, not because of our goodness. Lord, we're so far from perfect. But we found the Savior, and He's making a difference in our lives. And we thank you for that reality, and that's what we celebrate today on this Easter Sunday. Bless this whole day. Help us to remember, for we pray these things. In the name and the power of Jesus, our risen Savior. Amen. Amen. God.